गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पतान शृण्वन्मोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ओम। डियर् फ्रेण्ड्स्, वी आर् इन् दिस् विवेक चूडामणि। इन् दिस् एन्क्वैरी रिलेटिङ्ग् टु वाट् ईस् सेल्फ् अण्ड् वाट् ईस् नाट् सेल्फ्, शङ्कराचार्य इन् अ फ्यू वर्सस् ही हेस् डिस्क्रैब्ड् वाट् दिस् स्थूल शरीर ईस्। स्थूल शरीर मीन्स् द ग्रास् बाडी। द ग्रास् बाडी ईस् द प्रोडक्ट् आफ् द फैव् ग्रास् एलिमेण्ट्स्, सो दट् इस् वाट् ही डेमान्स्ट्रेटेड्। And then, in the last class, we read the 92nd sloka, which is starting with the, the subtle body. It is just an introduction to the subtle body. And in that introduction, we read this particular sloka, number 92, which talks about the 10 indriyas. That is, 5 jnanendriyas. Jnanendriyas means the organs of, sense organs, and the organs of action. So, these 10 things which we saw. The sloka was buddhindriyani shravanam tvagakshi ghranam cha jihva etc etc. So they are called buddhindriyas because they cognize things. These are the indriyas, these are the sense organs which cognize things and then present these pictures through the mind. So that is why they are called the buddhindriyani. And then they are actually the product of the sattva aspect of the five elements. The sattva aspect of the five elements, these are the buddhindriyani are the products. And then what about this vak pani pada payu upastha, the karmendriyani? These karmendriyani are from the rajas part, the rajas part of the five elements. So that is what we saw. And then now we have to read the 93rd sloka. So the 93rd sloka is talking about the antahkarana. We have seen the five indriyas. The five indriyas by themselves, they do not assess a thing. They are like cameras. They take the picture and then they present it to the mind. It is the mind which processes it and then understands it, examines what it is and then tries to assess what it is. So that is what is the function of the mind. And in the mind also there are certain functions, there are different levels of functions. So that we are going to see in this particular sloka, 93rd sloka. I will read. Nigadhyate antahkaranam manodhirahaṃ krutiścittam iti svavruttibhih manastu sankalpa vikalpanadibhih बुद्धिः परार्थाध्यवसाय धर्मतः अत्राभिमानादहमित्यहं कृतिः स्वार्थानुसंधानगुणेन चित्तम्। ऐ रेड् त्री लाङ्ग् लैन्स्, दट् ईस् वन् लैन्, देर् इस् ओन्ली वन् लैन् विच् इस् शोन् एस् वन् श्लोक। सो दिस् होल् थिङ्ग् रेप्रेसेण्ट्स् दि अन्तःकरण। अन्तःकरण ईस् अन्तः मीन्स् इण्टर्नल्, करणं मीन्स् आर्गन् आर् इन्स्ट्रुमेण्ट्। द इन्नर् इन्स्ट्रुमेण्ट्, वाट् इस् दट् इन्नर् इन्स्ट्रुमेण्ट्? इस् द मैण्ड् ओन्ली। सो दिस् अन्तःकरण is actually fourfold. Of course, because you have read Upanishads, you already know, but for a newcomer we have to explain that antahkarana, the mind, it functions at four levels. The first level is the impression it gets from the sense organs. The sense organs, they give just an impression to the mind. And then the mind is still in the indeterminate level. Indeterminate level means it has not decided whether it is X or Y, whether it is this or that. That is what is called sankalpa vikalpatmaka manaha. Sankalpa means a firm idea about, oh, this is X. Vikalpa is, there is a dilemma, whether is it X or Y. So, this the level at which just an impression is recorded in the mind and where the mind has not yet assessed it, that is the level of that indeterminate level, which is called manas. So the antahkarana at that level is called manas. Then after seeing it, then there is another faculty, the second level is to assess, this is that. This is X, this is a person and not some log of wood, this is something else, this is a chair and not something else. So this sort of adhyavasaya, it is called adhyavasaya or determination. So the determination is the next level, that is the next faculty, let us say. So that faculty is called buddhi. So the primary level is manas and then buddhi is the secondary level. Then it also occurs to me that, yeah, I know it. that notion of I, ahankruti. Ahankara, it does not mean, in normal usage, ahankara means arrogance, pride, that is what it means. But then here in Vedanta, aham means I. Ahankara means the notion of I, that's Purana, the idea of I. The idea of I is what is called ahankara. So that is another level. That is, I know, yeah, I know this, I have, I make this knowledge my own. So that is where, that is that I comes into picture. Then after some time, I recall it, okay, yeah, at that time I had met this gentleman, there was such interaction, and then at that time I had seen this, so this is what I like, this is what I do not like. So these are certain things which we recall to our mind. So this recollection level or that particular faculty is called chittam. So manas is the most primary level, buddhi is the secondary, that determining level. The third level is owning up that knowledge, yeah, I know it. So that is one thing. The third level, which is called ahankara. The fourth level is chittam. So that is what is mentioned here. Nigadhyate antahkaranam manodhirahaṁ krutis chittam iti svavrutti bhihi. This word svavrutti bhihi means by its own functions. Vrutti means a function. Because there are four different functions or four levels, we can say. By these four functions, it is called svavrutti means its own functions. So antahkaranam is that internal organ, manaha, dhihi means buddhi, then ahankruti is what is called ahankara, chittam iti nigadhyate means it is told, or it is called as manas, the same antahkaranam is called manas, it is called dhi, it is called ahankara, it is chittam by virtue of its different functions. So that is what it is. Then he is explaining what is manas. Manas tu sankalpa vikalpanadibhihi. Manaha, this mind, why is it called so? Sankalpa or vikalpa. Sankalpa is a clear idea, having a clear idea of an object. Vikalpa is having a doubt again. So, samshaya vikalpatpakam manaha. So that is vikalpa, vikalpanadibhihi. Buddhihi padarthadhyavasaya dharmataha. The property of buddhi, dharmataha means by that property, dharma means a property, dharmataha means by the property of or by virtue of what? Pada, artha, adhyavasaya. Pada means a particular object, pada, artha, the meaning of that padartha means an object, let us say, not meaning of a word, it is an object, padartha, an object, adhyavasaya, it understands what exactly it is. Suppose I speak something, you understand it. Or you see something, you understand it. So that is what is called adhyavasayatmika buddhihi. That is determinate in nature. So the indeterminate level or cognition is called manas. And a sort of definitive or determinate cognition is what is called buddhi. Then buddhi padartha adhyavasaya dharmataha. Then atra abhimanat ahamityaham krutihi. Abhimanat, yeah, I know it. Abhimana is I, the notion of I, ahankrutihi, abhimanat, that notion that I know it, so that is what is called ahankrutihi. Then svarthanusandhana gunena chittam, sva artha anusandhana. Anusandhana means again and again recalling. Sva artha, so that is a particular thing which you have seen, whatever you know it already, sva artha anusandhana gunena, by virtue of or by because of the faculty of. Because of the guna. Guna means a property. Because of the property of anusandhanam, because you are able to recall it again, and then you are able to think on it, deliberate on it, brood on it. So that is what is called chittam. Then he is talking about the five pranas. So this antahkaranam, as we see, is from, antahkaranam is also from the sattva aspect of the five elements. Sattva aspect of the five, sushma bhuta, not the grass bhuta. And then, it is again the samashti karya, the individual, indriyas, the sense organs, they are individually derived from those, elements. So, but here the mind, because it is able to see, it is able to smell, it is able to taste, it is able to do all the five functions of five indriyas. So, it is collective product. It is a collective product of the sattva aspect of the five elements. So, that is five sukshma elements. So that is what we have to see, we have to understand. Then the five prana. we are now talking about the prana. You see, sense organ is okay, but then life force also is needed, isn't it? So this life force also is part of this subtle body. You see, when you see a person, suppose there is a dead body. The dead body is there. It has no, this indriya shakti, the 10 organs are missing. Missing means physically they may be seen, but then the sense organs are not functioning. So that is that level. Suppose the sense organs are functioning, but prana is not there, the life vital force is not there. It is of no use. They cannot function actually. Strictly speaking, they cannot function unless the prana is there. They also go away along with the prana. So that is what Vedanta, we see in Vedanta. So this prana, it is derived from the rajoguna, because the rajoguna is responsible for activity. Sattva is responsible for knowledge, cognition, etc. Broadly, we can, a sort of thumb rule we can remember. As a sort of thumb rule, we have to remember that anything to do with the sense organs and then intelligence and indriyas, it is something related. Indriyas means jnanendriya. Then it is related to the sattva aspect. Anything related to energy, work, etc., etc., it is related to pranashakti. Pranashakti, it is called rajoguna. And then tamoguna, the gross aspect of it, the body, the skin, the blood, etc., etc., the muscle, etc., this is the tamoguna. This is the tamoguna aspect, is the tamo, from the tamoguna aspect, this body, gross body, is derived. So here, he is talking about the 5 pranas. In fact, there is only one prana. We have also seen in the Upanishad Bhashya also. Very recently, when we studied the Prashnopanishad also, we saw in that Prashnopanishad, the one prana becoming, doing 5 functions and called by 5 names, because it is functioning in 5 different ways. So that is what is being described in this shloka 95. Pranapanavyanodana samana bhavatyasau pranaha swayameva vrutti bhedad vikruti bhedat suvarna saliladivat. So here the meter, the chandas is changing, you see. Earlier we studied some other chandas. Now this is called Arya Vruttam. This chandas is called Arya Vruttam. So pranapana vyanodana samana bhavatyasau pranaha. Asau pranaha. This particular prana, it is one only. This particular prana, this life force is only one. That becomes bhavati. Bhavati means it becomes what? Prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. So it becomes 5-fold and then does 5 functions in the body. Of course, these 5 functions are not described here, but we know in other Upanishads also we have seen, and there are 1 or 2 lines in the Amarakosha, the dictionary. Hrudiprane means in the heart region. That pranavayu, that is, it is responsible for inhalation, exhalation, that is what is called pranavayu. Pranavayu, I am not talking about prana and apana. Prana, when you distinguish between prana and apana, that is a different context. The context there is, prana is exhalation and apana is inhalation. So that is what is a different context. But here the prana getting divided into 5 aspects, 5 functions is what is being told about. So here prana is Hrudiprane, that is responsible for inhalation, exhalation, etc. Gude apanaha, in the rectum portion, the apana, that is, it pushes out, it is responsible for the excretion, job of excretion, that is also important, that is very important. So that job of excretion is, that is done by apana vayu. Then apana, vyana, then prana, gude, hrudiprane, gude apanaha, samano nabhisamsthitaha. That shloka says, samano nabhisamsthitaha. Samana vayu is there in the nabhi area, that is in the navel portion, which means that it is responsible for the digestive system. It produces the heat or energy, heat which is needed for digesting the food. Samano nabhisamsthitaha. Udana kantadeshastu. Udana is something. Utana. That is, it is there responsible for speech, etc. And it is also responsible for transmigration. Of course, it is not mentioned here. We have seen in Prashnopanishad Bhashya that when this linga sharira, we are now of course going to see what is linga sharira. Sukshma sharira is the same as linga sharira. So it is not the atma which transmigrates. Atma is there everywhere. Atma is something like an infinity. Atma is there in the whole, I mean, it is there pervading the entire universe and beyond. So, Atma is not the thing which is transmigrating. It is the Jiva, or rather the Atma, the consciousness portion which is associated with this Antahkarana is called Jiva. So, that is what is transmigrating. And along with that is mind, indriyas, etc. They are also transmigrating. And the Vayu, the Prana which is responsible, it is somewhat like a courier. We read in that Prashnopanishad Bhashya, for this Apana, this Udana is somewhat like a sort of courier, a sort of electromagnetic wave which carries the sound or it carries something else. So like that, it is like that. So this Udana Vayu is responsible for transmigration of this Linga Sharira to another body. So when we see in that Gita Bhashya, people have a confusion. For example, Krishna says, what is this? Na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavitavana bhuyaha. This Atma is something which is never born, it never dies, it is always there, etc., etc. And then he says, jatasya hi dhruvam urtihu, dhruvam janma mrtasya cha. So everything which is born, it dies, and whatever is dhruvam janma mrtasya cha, etc., etc. What does it mean? So people see it as a contradiction because they don't understand it. So here you are talking about the pure Atma. In the first sentence, when you say najayate mriyateva, etc., etc., you are talking about the pure Atma. You are talking about the pure consciousness, which is illumining all antahkaranas, which is responsible for, it is somewhat like sun. The sun is illumining all the things on the globe, in the universe. But he is not affected by all our actions. So similarly, the antahkaran, Atma is like that. But then, the second place, what we are talking about, the jatasehi dhruva mrityu, you are talking about this upadhi. This upadhi called as sthola sharira and also sushma sharira. And also, of course, karana sharira is common to all. So, we are talking about this upadhi. This upadhi is born and then this upadhi dies. Of course, karana sharira does not die so easily. Linga sharira does not die so easily. Of course, we are going to see that, I will explain it. It is the sthola sarira which dies again and again and again. It is sthola sarira. And then this sukshma sarira, this subtle body, is something which transmigrates from body to body to body to body till a person gets enlightened. So that is what it is. So here, pranapana vyanodana samana bhavati asau pranaha. Asau pranaha, it becomes all these things. Then swayameva vrutti bhedat. That itself, by vrutti bhedat, vrutti means function. By virtue of its functions, swayameva itself, it becomes fivefold, vritti bhedat, vikruti bhedat, because it also undergoes some modification. Suvarna salilaadivat, suvarnavat, salilavat, suvarnadiva, suvarnavat, salilavat. Suvarna is gold, salilavat, salila is water. The gold becomes hundred thousands and thousands of varieties of ornaments. Similarly, water, it is an ocean, it is a river, it is a stream, it is in the form of a wave, it is in the form of a ripple, it is in the form of a bubble, it is in the form of some foam, etc., etc. So, water is seen in so many forms, and then gold is in so many forms. So, like that, this prana vayu also is seen in five forms, vrutti bhedat, by virtue of its different functions. Then the subtle body. We are now coming to the subtle body. Vagadi pancha, sravanadi pancha. So this subtle body, there is some difference of opinion among the same Advaita scholars regarding the count. Some people say it is 17 constituents. Here of course it is now, Shankaracharya is now showing about 24 constituents. There is some, of course, the principle is same. The principle is same, but here, of course, 24 constituents are shown. So here, let us see. Vagadi pancha, shravanadi pancha, pranadi pancha, bhramukhani pancha, buddhyadya vidyapi cha kamakarmani, buddhyadya vidyapi kamakarmani, puryashtakam sukshma shariram ahuhu, sukshma shariram ahuhu. People say that this is the sukshma shariram. Ahuhu, people say, what? Puriyashtakam, Puri plus Ashtakam, Puriyashtakam, the group of eight, or rather not group of eight, eight groups, Puriyashtakam, eight groups is called this collection of 8 groups, the collection of 8 groups is called Sukshma Sharira. What are these 8? Number 1 is Vagadi Pancha. Vak Adi. Vak is what? It is a Karmendriya. It is the organ of action, isn't it? Vak, Pani. Pani is hand. Payu. Payu is rectum. Vak, Pani, Pada. Pada is feet, legs. Then again, what? Payu and Upastha. The rectum and genitals. So, these 5 are the organs of action. So, Vagadi Pancha. It is called Karmendriya. Then Shravanadi Pancha, the 5 Shravana Adi. Shravana, what is this? Shrotra, Tvak, Chakshu, Grana, Rasana, 5 sense, 5 sense functions are there, isn't it? So these 5 sense functions, they are the sense organs. The organs are called the sense organs. Shravanadi Pancha. Then Pranadi Pancha, we have just seen how the Pranavayu is called. Is divided into 5 different, it is known as 5 vayus by virtue of different functions. So it is Pranadi Pancha. So 5 vayus which are there in the body. And then Abhramukhani Pancha. Abhra, what is Abhra? Abhra means, there are 2 meanings for that. Abhra, Abhram Megho Varivahaha. Abhra also refers to cloud. But here of course we are not talking about cloud. Abhra is referring to space. Space. Abhramukhani, space, etc. Pancha. What are they? The 5 elements, not in the gross form, the 5 sukshma elements, the 5 subtle in their subtle form. Abhramukhani Pancha. Mukha. Abhramukhani, Mukhani is etc. Abhramukhani, Abhramukhaha, Abhra, etc. So like that. Because it is Mukhani, because it is in, they are in neuter gender. So that is why it is called Mukhani. If it were to be masculine, it would have been Mukhaha. Abhramukhani Pancha. Then Buddhyadi. Buddhi Adi. What are they? 4. Antahkarana Chatushtayam. Buddhyadi. Buddhyadi. Avidyapi. Buddhyadi Avidyapi. Avidya, which is the karanam for all these things. Avidya, first of all, it is also called Maya. It is also called Prakruti. So we have to tentatively, let us not go into very great details about some school of thought talks about avidya and maya, because there is a lot of discussion on what is avidya, what is maya, so etc. etc. There is a lot of discussion in Vedanta, in the advanced texts of Vedanta. We will not go into all that. Tentatively we will see, and everybody accepts that tentatively what is avidya is same as maya. Then the same thing is called prakriti also. Then when you go to, in some contexts, even the word pradhanam also is used. The Sankhyas, they use the word pradhanam, and we also accept the word sometimes, and then we also use the word pradhanam. So these are the synonyms. So buddhyadi avidyapi, because in that Brahman which is pure, which is of the nature of pure consciousness, this manifesting power which we are calling maya, it is always there. It is anadi avidya. It is not as though it manifests for some time. In one particular portion of Brahma, it is not like that. It is there all through. So that is why the Srishti is eternal. And the eternal cycles of creation, not one creation. Now we are called Vaivasvata Manvantara. When we do our puja, what do we say? Vaivasvata Manvantara, Ekaliyuge, Prathama Upade, Jambudvipe, Bharatavarsha, etc. etc. We say. What is this Vaivasvata Manvantara? In one particular creation, this particular creation which is supposed to be going on, this Vivasvan or the sun god's sun god himself, Vivasvan, he is the Manu, he is the creator in this Prajapati. He is the Prajapati, Vaivasvata Manvantara. So there may be something to do with the solar system. We do not know whether our ancestors migrated from some other solar system to this solar system. We do not know. Maybe they started calling it Vaivasvata Manvantara. We do not know. So because now the science is now saying that a human being cannot exist on this planet for not more than a few hundred years by virtue of the advanced technology we have developed. Because we have developed such great technology which is likely to destroy the earth itself. So we have to find some other planet in some other solar system. So maybe, we do not know, this Vaivasvata Manvantara may be referring to that. Of course, I am not seriously saying, I am only So he's saying about the possibility, vaivasvata manvantara. Stephen Hawking very recently, only a few days ago, he said, only about 3-4 days ago, there was some statement by Stephen Hawking. So he was saying that man cannot survive on this earth for maybe another, not more than 300 to 400 years. So that is what he was saying. So that is it. So like that, anyway, puryastaka, till that time all these things they hold good. So puryastakam sukshma shariramahuhu with avidyapi cha kama karmani. So there is another word also there. Kama. Kama is desire. Because of avidya, there is a kama. Because of why because of avidya there is kama. It is not when you say that somebody is having a desire for something, you should not label that it is because of ignorance. It is ignorance, we are talking at a higher level, not at a personal level. When somebody says, I want this, we should not say that it is due to ignorance. So, avidya, we are talking at a higher level. Avidya is making this Chaitanya, Shuddha Chaitanya, feel that it is confined to a small limited body-mind complex. So, when you feel that you are limited to a particular body-mind complex, then you need that, you need something else, you need food and water, you need something else, you need some comforts, you feel happy with something, you feel unhappy with something else. So this kama is due to the feeling of inadequacy, the notion of inadequacy, the notion of incompleteness. So that is what it is. So that kama is, and then that notion of incompleteness promotes a man or propels a man into action to fulfill whatever desire he wants. So that is what is the relationship between kama and karma. Karma is always prompted by kama. There is a motivation, there is a desire. Now of course, we make a virtue of it, isn't it? If somebody is having some high motivation and then if he is a great achiever, naturally it is treated as a virtue. But of course, we are in a different context. We are in the context of Vedanta. In Vedantic context, we are technically observing what it is. It may be a great achievement from the worldly level. At the worldly level, at the transactional level, it may be a great achievement. But we are now analyzing in a philosophical context. In a philosophical context, kama is something which promotes or propels a man into action. So that is what this sthula sharira, sukshma sharira is. So what all did we see? 5 pranendriya, vagadi, organs of action. Then 5 sense organs. Then 5 pranas, then 5 subtle elements, pancha, abhramukhani pancha, so altogether 20. Then buddhyadi, if you count buddhi as one alone, it becomes 1. Avidya, buddhi, that is with buddhi 21, avidya 22, kama 23, and 24 is karma. Karma is action. Karma action is, it can be dharma and adharma. Dharma is legal, adharma is illegal. So, virtuous, unvirtuous, what is this? It is not unvirtuous. What is the word? Virtuous or something unrighteous, let us say. Righteous and unrighteous. So, that is what we can see. Then, the next shloka is also about the same linga sharira. So, this 97th shloka I am reading. Idam shariram shrunu sukshma sangnitam. Lingam tvapanchikurta bhuta sambhavam savasanam karmaphalanubhavakam swajnanatonadirupadhiratmanah. So idam shariram shrunu sukshma sangnitam. Shrunu means suno, listen. This idam shariram is sukshma sangnitam. What shariram? Apanchikurta bhuta sambhavam idam shariram. He is not talking about the physical body. He is talking about apanchikurta bhuta sambhavam. So apanchikurta bhuta, what are they? That is the 5 elements which are not mixed yet. That unquintuplicated, I used that word called quintuplication, panchikaranam. That is the 5 subtle elements combining in a particular proportion and then becoming gross. So before that state, it is called apanchikurta. That is unmixed so far, unadulterated, let us say, unmixed. Adulterated may be a bad word, but say unmixed, let us say. So in their elemental forms, apanchikurta bhuta sambhavam. So this linga sharira is something which is a product of this apanchikurta bhuta. When you say it is a product, then what does it mean? whatever is born is something which is not eternal. The basic idea is to say that it is not Atma. In the sthula sharira also, what we saw was sthula sharira cannot be Atma. Sthula sharira is there today, it goes away tomorrow. Atma is something which is eternal. So it cannot be Atma. Sthula sharira, you may decorate, you may do your hairstyle for 1 hour a day, and then you can say do makeup and what not, but all that say goes away. So that sthula sharira cannot be Atma. Then linga sharira may linger on for some time, but then it is also not eternal, because that is what he says, apanchikrita bhuta sambhavam. When you say it is sambhavam, sambhavam means it is originated from that, it is born out of that, it has arisen out of it. When you say that, anything which is born is something which is non-eternal. So basically to show that it is not Atma. So apanchikrita bhuta sambhavam, lingam tu, this lingam is referring to linga shariram. This is lingam. Lingam is what? This linga shariram sukshma sangnitam. Sukshma sangnitam idam shariram lingam. Sukshma sangnitam means that which is designated as a sukshma, that which is designated as a subtle. So that particular sharira is something which is lingam. Lingam for what? He is using this word in the etymological sense, because I am speaking from the commentary of Chandrasekhara Bharati Swami, Srungeri Swami. So this he says, lingyate anena iti lingam. Lingyate anena. Why is it called lingam? Lingam is something which is a jnapakam, which is an indicator. It indicates. So it is called lingam because it is only here that the presence of the Atma, presence of the Chaitanya can be recognized. It cannot be recognized in the gross body. It is recognized only in the mind, because this is Chaitanya is what is getting reflected in the mind, and then because this mind is able to cognize things, mind is able to know things, mind is able to analyze things, then we are aware of the presence of a particular thing which is enabling this to do all these things. It is like sun's light falling on a mirror, and this mirror is reflecting, and then we are able to see the reflection. So in that reflected light, you are able to see lot many things. So like that, this Chaitanya which is getting reflected in the Antahkarana, it is responsible for illumining it so that you are able to see things. So that is what is the thing. So that is why it is lingam. It is the indicator. It indicates the presence of this Atma. Otherwise, there is no other indicator. If it were to be gross body alone, gross body is not the indicator for the presence of Atma. It is the linga sharira which is enable us to deduce, to visualize that there is something, which is enabling us to know that there is something which is beyond this linga sharira, which is that eternal Atma, which is illumining all these things. So lingam tu apanchikrita bhuta sambhavam. So it is called linga because it is the medium in which Chaitanya is getting reflected. So it is not so in the sthula sharira. We have seen this in Keno Upanishad also. Pratibodha viditam matam amrutatvam hi vindate. Pratibodha viditam matam. In every cognition, we can see the presence of that Chaitanya. So that is what he says. So lingam tu apanchikrita bhuta sambhavam. Then savasanam, not shavasanam. Shavasana we find in yoga. This is savasana. Vasana is what? It is from the root vasa. Vasa means to dwell. Vasana is something which dwells. What is it that dwells? So suppose any human interaction is something which creates an impression on the mind. Any human interaction, not only human, it applies to all animals, etc., etc. So any interaction we have, it has some impression on the mind. Some impressions may go away very, very fast. Some impressions may be there etched in the mind for a longer time. So that is called latent impressions, what we call latent impressions. Suppose you touch heat, a child touches heat and then the finger burns. And then next time the child doesn't touch it because it is there in the mind. So it is this vasana of that thing, of its that particular experience, it is determining the future behavior of that child. So that is vasana. Vasana is something which is there, a latent impression which is there in our minds. And then it is influencing our future behavior also. That is savasana. Vasana is also called samskara. Samskara. which is there in the mind. So these are also called tendencies or latent impressions. So this mind is something which is savasanam. It is having a vasana. Then karma phalanubhavakam, this is another factor. So this is the thing, this linga sharira is the one which enjoys, which suffers, which feels I am great, I am supreme, I am a great person, I am a great achiever, etc., etc. All this notion of I, all these things, it is not for the body. Even if the body is great, the body by itself is not, thinking itself great. It is the mind which is thinking, yeah, I am so strong, etc., etc. So it is the mind, karma phalanubhavakam, that is anubhavakam, means which makes you to enjoy. Anubhavati is different, anubhavayati is different. Anubhavayati is, it is making it experience. It is anubhavakam means it is making us experience this sukha and dukkha. Karma phalanubhavakam. So where this sukha, dukkha, whatever all the experiences of happiness, unhappiness, etc., they are for the linga sharira. Suppose somebody honors you and you feel very proud that sammana, etc., etc. Physical body, of course, physical body is respected, that's a different thing. That also we saw, puja, avamana, etc., etc. But it is also that linga sharira is the one which derives happiness out of it or feels sad about it. So the sukha, dukkha, etc., they are all related to linga sharira. Karma phala anubhavakam. This karma phala. Karma phala is whether it is a good result or bad result of any previous karma. It is the linga sharira which experiences. And also here we can say karma phalam. Suppose somebody goes to heaven as a result of karma phala. Then which is the body which goes to that heaven? This linga sharira in a special form it goes, linga sharira only it goes, in a special form it goes, and then what all it enjoys there, it is only in the form of mind only, not in the form of physical body. There is no physical body, it is only in the form of mind it enjoys, it dances with Ramba, it dances with Urvasi, etc., etc. All those things, they are at the linga sharira level. Then why is it so? Sva-ajnanataha, by its own ajnana. Because of its identification with this ajnana, here we can take it as identification with the body-mind complex. Because of its identification with this thing, swajnanataha anadhi upadhi ratmanaha. This ajnana is anadhi upadhihi atmanaha. For this atma, it is anadhi upadhi. Anadhi means beginningless. Beginningless upadhi. Because this maya is coeval with Brahma. So ever since, so many cycles of creation have taken place. Even this linga sharira does not die during even pralaya. What we talk of pralaya or total dissolution, in that pralaya also this linga sharira doesn't die. Linga sharira is there in some seed form and it is there in that creator form, creator. And then when again the next creation comes, the next creator again creates, and then by virtue of the karma in the previous creation, you take another body there in the next creation, in the next cycle of creation, let us say. So it is a slightly complicated structure which we have visualized to see that a person is totally responsible for his action. A person will get the result of his karma, whether it is good or bad, and then he will experience that unless as a first step you do nishkama karma, and then as a second step you practice this dhyana yoga, you practice meditations and other things, and then you also follow worship, this means of bhakti yoga, and then you get enlightened by sravana manana nididhyasana. So that is what we see in Vedanta. So savasanam karma phalanubhavakam sva jnanatah anadi upadhihi atmanah. Atmanah means for the Atman. It is the ageless or beginningless upadhi. Upadhi, we know what is an upadhi. Upadhi is something which is a delimiting factor. It is a delimiting factor. Atma is unlimited. Atma is infinite. For that unlimited Atma, which is of the nature of infinite, this upadhi, this linga sharira, is something which is somewhat like a delimiting factor. If you take the whole akasha, and then the whole akasha, suppose I also, there is akasha here also. So this akasha which is there in this cup, he is delimited in this cup. This akasha delimited to the cup. So it is only a delimiting factor. So like this cup which is a delimiting factor, this cup becomes the upadhi. It is a delimiting factor. So similarly for that chaitanya which is infinite, so this linga sharira becomes a small upadhi or a delimiting factor. Then, so this point also I said, this linga sharira doesn't die till one attains liberation by knowledge. Then the next shloka is by, is also about linga sharira. It is explaining what are the peculiar, what is the peculiarity or what is the distinguishing feature of this linga sharira. So it is saying, Svapno bhavatyasya vibhaktyavastha swamatra sheshena vibhati yatra svapne tu buddhihi swayameva jagratkalina nanavidha vasanabhihi. Next line also I can read, kartradi bhavam pratipadya rajate yatra swayam bhati yatra swayam jyotirayam paratma. Your book says swayam jyotihi, but here this book says swayam bhati hyayam paratma. But I find that version Patantaram is more appropriate. Swayam Jyotirayam Paratma, that is the Shringeri edition, which I find is a better edition. So Swapno Bhavati Asya. Asya. Asya means for this subtle body. For this subtle body, Swapnaha Vibhaktyavastha Bhavati. Vibhakti. Vibhakti avastha means a particular state. Vibhaktyavastha means a particular distinguishing state. Because Swapna is something which distinguishes this linga sharira. And if we do not have Swapna, we do not know we can't immediately explain the linga sharira. We can't understand the linga sharira. Because in the Jagrat Avastha, when we in the waking state, all our senses are functioning. And then we do not know what exactly is the linga sharira. In sleep, what happens? When you are having a dream, then all these external organs are withdrawn. All the organs are withdrawn. When the organs are withdrawn, still the mind is able to project a whole new world there. Mind is able to project a whole new world because of Chaitanya only. Mind itself cannot do that. Mind, or rather Chaitanya in association with the mind, or Chaitanya reflecting in the mind, it is producing a whole new world in that dream. So that is why it is called Swayam Jyoti. That particular word I will explain. So this Swapna or a dream is something which is the distinguishing factor or a distinguishing state for that subtle body. For the subtle body, Swapna is the distinguishing state. So Swapno Bhavatyasya Vibhakti Avastha, that is Asya. Asya Linga Sharirasya Vibhakti Avastha, Swapnaha Vibhakti Avastha Bhavati. So that is a construction. This dream is a distinguishing factor there, distinguishing state there. Then how swamatra sheshena vibhati yatra. Yatra, where swamatra sheshena, it alone remains and shines. It alone remains and then shines. So that swapna alone, in that swapna, this the mind in association with this chaitanya, or rather chaitanya in association with the mind, that alone remains and then it shines. That alone remains means what? All other external organs are withdrawn. The organs of action and organs of senses, all the 10 organs are withdrawn. So that is why it is called swamatra sheshena. By remaining alone, it shines. What does it mean, vibhati? Shines means it is able to produce. It is having intelligence. Whenever you use the word shine, it is associated with intelligence. That is, it is projecting a new world there in that dream. Then Swapnetu Buddhihi Swayameva, in this Swapna, Swapnetu, in the Swapna, Buddhihi Swayameva Jagratkalina Nanavidha Vasanabhihi. How does it shine? Jagratkalina Nanavidha Vasanabhihi. There are so many Vasanas. I told you, Vasana means a latent impression. Something which is which is there lodged in the mind, which is there etched in the mind. All these things, they come to focus in the dream. So jagrat kalina vasanabhihi, this vasana is something relating to jagrat kalina. During day you are having an interaction, in the night you have a dream about it. So this jagratkalina vasana again comes up in the dream. Jagratkalina vasana bhihi, this mind is able to swayameva rajate. It is shining by itself. It is not the mind which is shining. It is atma through this mind which is shining. Swayameva rajate. Swayameva jagratkalina nanavidha vasana bhihi vibhati. It shines there. And then the next line also we have to see. Kartradibhavam pratipadya rajate. Rajate means Raja, you know, Raja is a king. Rajate means like a lord, he functions. Rajate. Rajate is it shines, it functions. Raja also means function, shining. Rajate, virajate, use the word virajate. So how kartradibhavam pratipadya. Having assumed the idea of doership, kartradibhavam, I am the doer, I am the owner, I am the sufferer. In dream, suppose you are being felicitated by somebody. So you are having that great sense of honor. In the dream, you are doing something, you think you are the karta there. In the dream, you are doing, so you are experiencing something. So you feel that you are the enjoyer of it. So all these kartra, kartru, bhoktru, etc., all the notions you are having, you are assuming in that dream. So pratipadya, pratipadya means having assumed. Kartradi bhavam pratipadya rajate. So the person shines. Who? Person doesn't mean a person. I am talking about the linga sharira. Linga sharira asya, linga sharira asya. That is what we are talking about. Then yatra swayam jyotihi hayam paratma. This paratma, the supreme atma which we call Brahman. So that is what is actually the jyoti, swayam jyoti. So this Swayam Jyoti is a word which we frequently come across in Vedanta. Swayam Jyoti, there is a particular portion in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad which is called Jyotir Brahmanam. In Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there are several sections. Each section is called a Brahmanam. So Brahmanam has nothing to do with Brahmins. Brahmana is something which is an elaboration on the mantra portions, on the Samhita portion. It is something which is an elaboration on the mantra portions. So in that particular Brahmanam, there is a discussion. Yajnavalkya, as usual, Yajnavalkya was a very, very great, enlightened man of those times. In the court, he used to have discussion with several scholars in the court of Janaka. So in that particular Brahmanam, there is a discussion about the dream state, etc., all the three states. So in that, what is that? What is the jyoti or what is the illumining thing in the dream? So atra atmanaiva swayam jyoti, atmanaiva idam swayam jyoti hi bhavati. There is some particular line there. What is that line? Kim jyotirayam purushaha. In that dream, kim jyotirayam purushaha. This particular person or this particular being, kim jyotihi. What is it which illumines that dream? The discussion is like that. So all that portion has been summarized by Shankaracharya in one particular shloka called Eka Shloki. So in one particular shloka, he has summarized that whole discussion in that Jyotir Brahmana. So he summarizes in this way. Suppose during the day, how is it that we are able to cognize things? We are able to cognize things by our five senses because the sun is there, the moon is there, the sun is there, there is so much of visibility. And then all these things we are able to cognize. So that is during the day, it is the sun which is able to give us that light. Suppose it is a night. In the night there can be moon. Suppose the moon also is not there. There can be fire. There can be electricity light. In olden days it was fire, a lamp. Nowadays it is electricity, let us say. When electricity is not there, then walk. Suppose you are walking in a jungle where there is absolutely pitch darkness. So there, you use your voice to find out where the other person is. Suppose somebody calls from a distance. So you find out in what direction, from what direction the voice is coming. And then you can also approximately guess the distance, etc. So that walk is something. When the walk also is missing, then your atma, your consciousness alone is the Swayam Jyoti. Swayam Jyotihi. So in that way, he summarizes that particular word called Swayam Jyoti. So here in this dream, it is the consciousness alone which in association with the mind, which having reflected on the mind, it is able to project a whole new world in that dream. So that is what it is. Svayam Jyotihi Ayam Paratma. This Supreme Atma is self-luminous. Svayam Jyoti. Literally the word Svayam Jyoti means self-luminous. So what is this self-luminous nature? Because this is the Atma which is reflecting in every Antahkarana. And because of that reflection only, the mind is able to project that particular world. So here what we see is, so this one point which we have to see is, this Linga Sharira is not the Svayam Jyoti. It is not the Linga Sharira which is Svayam Jyoti. It is the Atma which is Svayam Jyoti. Atma is functioning through the Linga Sharira. So that is one point we have to see. Then we have to, another point which we have to note is that self-luminous nature is something which always exists in Brahman, isn't it? It always exists in Brahman. Then why do you say that here it is Svayam Jyoti? Atra ayam purushah Svayam Jyoti. Here it is Svayam Jyoti. Why do you say? Because it is seen there. In all other places it is so mixed up. In Sushupti, there is even dream is not there. There is no vastu to be seen. In Sushupti, there is no drushya vastu to be illumined. But in Jagratavastha, it is mixed up with the indriyas and the cognitions of indriyas. Oh, it is only in the dream state, when the indriyas are withdrawn, this self-luminous nature of Atma is very, very clearly evident. So that is why it is called Svayam Jyoti. It doesn't mean that Atma is not Svayam Jyoti during day. Atma is not Svayam Jyoti during Sushupti. It doesn't mean that. Atma is always Svayam Jyoti. But its Svayam Jyoti Stvam, the fact that it is Svayam Jyoti is clearly known during that time. Because it is somewhat like highlighted at that particular time. So that is the point which we have to see. It is clearly demonstrated in the dream state. Then Kartradi Bhavam Pratipadya Rajate Yatra Svayam Jyoti Rayam Paratma. Then he is further explaining that Svayam Jyoti is something which is not affected by the karma of the human being. So the next shloka, that is 99th shloka, it says, Dhimatra Kopati Rasesha Sakshi Nalipyate Tatkruta Karma Lepaihi. What does your book say? Karma Lepaihi or Lepaihi? That's correct. This book says Leshaihi. Karma Lepaihi. Yasmad asangas tata eva karma bhihi nalipyate kinchid upadhina krutaihi. So dhimatraka upadhihi ashesha sakshi. So ashesha sakshi. So here we are getting a new word called sakshi. What is a sakshi? Sakshi is something which is a witness. Witness is something which has no kartrutva, which has no doership. It is something which is there. Here, even this word witness also we have to understand that witness is, seeing also is some function, isn't it? So here it is not as though Atma is something which is seeing all your activity. Atma is something which is illumining. It is not Surya, when the sun is illumining the whole area. It doesn't mean that Surya is actually seeing all the thing. There is no function called seeing on the part of Surya. Similarly, there is no function called seeing on the part of this Chaitanyam. But still, conventionally it is called Sakshi. So that is what we have to understand. Sakshi doesn't mean that there is somebody who is sitting here and then some Farishta type of thing and then watching everything. It is not like that. So, Dhimatra, Ashesha Sakshi. Sakshi is that witness consciousness. It is called witness consciousness, or the consciousness which is illumining that particular Antahkarana. So that is what is Sakshi. That is Ashesha Sakshi. Ashesha means what? Ashesha means endless. That means witness for all. Witness not only for you and me. It is the witness for all Antahkaranas. It is there in all Antahkaranas. It is Antaryami for all Antahkaranas. Ashesha Sakshi. Then Ashesha Sakshi is Dhimatraka Upadhihi. So this Dhi alone is its Upadhi. Upadhi is the Dhi alone. So it is reflected in that Dhi alone. Dhi here means Antahkarana. We need not make a subtle distinction between Mana, Buddhi, Ahankara, Chittam, etc. Dhi here, we can totally take it as Antahkarana. So this Antahkarana is the Upadhi, that is the delimiting factor for this, limitless consciousness, which is the Antaryami, which is the indwelling self of all, which is the illuminer of all. then nalipyate tatkruta karma lepaihi, and then whatever action a human being does, this sakshi is not getting affected by that. It is the linga sharira which is getting affected by that. That we have to see. Who is getting affected? It is the linga sharira. It is the linga sharira which is supposed to go to another body, which is supposed to take up another body, depending on the good or bad karma, and then it is the linga sharira which has to enjoy or suffer the fruit of that karma. It is not sakshi. Sakshi Chaitanya is there also. Sakshi Chaitanya continues always. So that is what it is said. Na lipyate. Na lipyate means it doesn't get tainted. Lepanam. Lepanam means something like an ointment. Suppose you take an ointment. Lepanam strictly means ointment. Lepanam also means the act of anointing, the act of rubbing some ointment or pasting something. So nalipyate, it is not tainted, it is not pasted, it is not anointed, something like that. So nalipyate tat kruta karma lepaihi, it is not affected by whatever action is done by the human being. Then yasmad, because it is asangaha, it is asanga. Tatayeva, because of that, karma bhihi nalipyate kinchid upadhina krutaihi. You see, all these actions are done by the upadhi and not by the sakshi. Upadhi is the thing which is the karta, bhokta, etc., etc., but not this pure consciousness which is a mere sakshi. So, is it clear? Dhimatra kopadhihi. So, it is like sun, it is totally untouched by the activities of the upadhi. So, then the next shloka is talking about the same upadhi, it is continuing. Here again the meter is different. The meter again is Arya Vruttam. Sarvavyapritikaranam lingamidam syat chidatmanah pumsah vasyadikamiva takshnah tenaivatma bhavatyasangoyam. So sarvavyapritikaranam lingamidam. Idam lingam. This particular linga sharira. Idam lingam is this particular linga sharira. Sarva vyapruti karanam. Karanam means the instrument. Instrument for sarva vyapruti. Instrument for all activities. Vyapruti is vyapara. Vyapara means an activity. Activity. Sarva vyapruti karanam. It is an instrument for all activities. This idam lingam, sarva vyapruti karanam. It is the instrument for all activities. Then lingam idam karanam syat chidatmanaha pumsaha. But in reality, what is the reality of this person? This person is Chidatma. Of this Chidatmanaha Pumsaha. For this person. Person means we are not referring to a person. We are referring to the real self of that. For this real self of a person, that is what is called Chidatmanaha Pumsaha. Pumsaha. It is, the real nature is Chidatma. His real self is Chit plus Atma Chidatma. Chit is intelligence. Atma is self. The intelligence is its self for this being. But unfortunately, this is the linga sharira, is the upadhi. It is sarvakarana, sarva vyapriti karana. It is the upadhi for that chidatma. Then vasyadikameva takshanaha. This takshan, takshan is a word. Takshakaha also is a word. Takshan also is a word. Takshan means a carpenter. Takshan is a carpenter. Takshanaha is Shashti Ekavachanam, that is possessive case singular. That is, for a carpenter, there is some way tool. For example, he takes some sort of chisel or something like that, and then he keeps on, carving the wood. Suppose he is trying to carve the wood with a chisel. So, that's Vasyadikam eva. Vasya means that instrument. Vasyadikam, chisel, etc., etc. He may have any number of instruments. So, for a carpenter, just as this chisel is for a carpenter. Similarly, this linga sharira also is a sort of karanam. It is a sort of instrument for this atma whose real nature is, the real nature is chidatma. That is, which is the real nature is that of pure consciousness. Vasyadikame patakshanaha tenaiva atma bhavati asangoyam. Tenaiva atma bhavati. Because of that reason, it is asangaha. Tenaiva asangaha. Why? What does it mean? Tenaiva means upadhina eva. Because it is only when the upadhi is there, it becomes, there is a vyapara. When the upadhi is not there, देर इज नो व्यापार तेनैव भवति असंग तेनैव भवति तेनैव आत्मा भवति असंगः अयम् सो वी विल कंक्लूड दिस इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास द लास्ट वन स्मॉल लाइन इज देर वी विल कंक्लूड इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास हरिः ओम तत्सत्।